Alrighty, we're back finally. I mean, I think it's been like 10 or 11 days since the 31st. Yeah, like 10 or 11 days since my last upload, which isn't a ton of time, but in internet time, that's like a lifetime. So, it feels good to be back. I mean, I just got back like a day ago, so I'm sorry if this is going to be a super jumbled video. I haven't had a whole lot of time to prepare for it. Regardless, I'll just give you a quick overview of what I'm going to go over in this video. The first thing is a portfolio update. A lot has happened in the past week. It's been a good week as far as stocks are concerned. A lot of news has happened. I've kept up with everything, so I have a lot of ground to cover and make up this week. The next thing I want to do is just give a portfolio update and then give the monthly update. But now we're in June. I'm going to tell you how much money I made in May with dividends, how the cash flow is going, and how that's trending. And then the main subject of this video is going to be Costco. Yes, Costco, which you might be wondering, why am I picking Costco to go over? That seems kind of random. They haven't really made the news. Well, that's the thing about Costco. They never make the news. They're the most boring company ever, and they're also one of my self-professed favorite companies ever. So I'm going to go over this company, why it has the top place out of what I think are all really good companies, except for Comcast. All these fantastic companies that return a lot of value to their shareholders. I think Costco is just top tier. So I'm going to be going over my case for Costco, having that bias said of it just being one of my favorite companies ever. But anyways, I'm going to do a full analysis of that. Look at this company, go over all of it. And then I think there's one news item I want to cover. I won't go into any questions or answers this video. I did a lot in the previous one. I'll do more in the next. But I want to go over one news story, and that is Buffett, somebody won the auction to have lunch with him. And they paid $4.57 million just to have a lunch with him. And they did it for a very specific reason. And I will give you that reason at the end of this video. But I think it will be intriguing, and I think it will make a lot of news when he does actually sit down with him. Anyway, before I jump into the subject at hand, I wanted to announce, if you go to the description of this video, you can get a link to my Instagram. Yes, I have an Instagram now. It's brand new. The name of it is Joe Carlson Show. So if you go to Instagram and the handle on it is Joe Carlson Show, all one word. Don't have a whole lot of followers right now. I'm pretty sure all 13 of these are bots, but I have one post and it is a little teaser of what my next video is going to be. It gives kind of a hint of what my next video is going to be. So if you want to see that as well as more content and me posting some things like behind the scenes about my trips and daily life and that type of stuff, as well as little backstage stuff about my content, I'm going to be doing a lot more here. I also have my Twitter. I feel like Twitter is a little bit more public. It's just like blasted out to everybody. So I think Instagram will be fun to post a little bit more personalized content there. So anyway, go ahead and follow that if you're interested in following it. And other than that, I'll get started. So obviously, the past week has been pretty good in the stock market if you've been paying attention to what's been going on. If I look over, let's go to a 1 month view here of just the S&P 500. So if I look at the 1 month view, we had this point where Thursday, May 16th, the stock market just started to go down week after week after week. And this is where you get all the talk of the yield curve and Fed rates and inflation and whether we're going into another recession. And there's just negativity over and over and over again. What I did is I released a video, one talking about risk, like right here, and then another one on May 31st saying that for new investors that just got in and are losing money, that they've lost like 2 or 3% of the capital gains of what they've invested, this is a great opportunity for you to look and see if your risk tolerance, if your risk in your portfolio is tailored to your risk tolerance. And if it's not, you can adjust it because you probably haven't lost a whole lot in the grand scheme of things. If you just started investing, you probably have a couple thousand dollars, and that's really not a whole lot in the grand scheme of things. So regardless, what happened after that video, the market kept going down and then it started to recover. And over just the past week, maybe week and a half, it's gone and recovered pretty much all the losses over the past month. If I look at that now and I compare that to my portfolio did not go up as much as the S&P 500 in the past week, but it also did not fall as much as the S&P 500 in the prior weeks before that. That's because my portfolio is more conservative, has what's called a lower beta, which means it just has lower volatility. And that's what I want with this portfolio. Regardless, if I look at this, I have $40,500 in this now. It's gone up quite a bit since the last video. I mean, it's been a good amount of time, but the reason this has gone up so much is because this went from negative like $1,000 in a week to positive $600. So I've made back a lot of the losses and even made some gains. And then on top of that, I'd made a lot of deposits. So if I look at the past week real quick, we have $28.26 earned dividends. If I go to the past month view, this is the last 30 days since May 10th, earned dividends, $156.58. So this earned dividends over the past 30-day period continues to go up and up. And then I want to look at the activity and see what's been going on with this portfolio. Now, obviously, I have deposits mixed in with almost all of these. If I look at this, I mean, deposited like 500 here, 100 here, 400 here. So I've made a lot of deposits over the past week. But what I want to focus on is the amount of dividends, because the dividends don't have to do anything with me. And what I like to see with this portfolio under the activity tab is a lot of activity. That's what I like to see, a lot of things going on. I don't want this to just be dead, not have anything for week after week, and have the last activity be like 30 or 40 days ago. So if I look at this, 14 days ago, dividends, $2.67. Not a whole lot, but it's something, and it helps buy some of these shares and these bonds. 11 days ago, $14.17. Welltower, bought BNDX. That's a new holding I added into my bond pie. This is international corporate bonds, so I'm getting exposure to Europe and Canada. 8 days ago, dividends, $25.03 from Simon Property and LTC. They bought a bunch of these banks. If I go 5 days ago, $8.62 from Visa, Aflac, Wells Fargo, United Parcels, and Phillips 66. And these helped buy shares of these different eight companies, a bunch of different financial ones as well. And then we go to 4 days ago, $16.32. BNDX paid a little bit. Southern Company paid a lot, $15.63. And that purchased these fractional shares of these five different companies again. And then 14 hours ago, $27.02. All my treasuries and my bonds paid out at the same time. And then I also have Boeing and Amgen and Pfizer paying out. And that was enough to help purchase all these shares in these financial and healthcare companies. So what you can see is my portfolio has a lot of stuff going on, even if I had no involvement here. I have deposits, but even if I didn't deposit anything, I would still be being paid all these dividends. And these dividends would be constantly buying shares and constantly compounding. That's what I want to see. When I look at this on my gain, again, the market gain, this just goes up and down, but this earned dividends continually goes up. $948 in earned dividends. This is almost $1,000 of earned dividends, and that's $1,000 being put to work buying more shares of all these productive companies and this credit and corporate and treasuries that helps continue that snowball. And that's really the purpose of this portfolio. Now, looking at that, we have the May results of how much money I made in May. This is earned dividends. Let's go ahead and check out the graph. Monthly dividends, you can see May, I earned $98.82. So we have from here, January, $25, February, $71, March, $108, April, $123, and May, $99. Now, this is what happens a lot. The companies do not pay all at the same schedule. So I have clusters of companies that pay on different months, and more of them will pay like on, you know, a lot of them paid on April. So I have 123, not as many paid on May, but overall this should continue to go up. If it's trending, it's trending in the upward position. This is really what I care about. I want to get it so that my income overall month to month, the average is just higher and higher and higher with it, because I don't intend on living on capital gains. I intend on living on the dividends. I hope to see that this continues to go up. I want to get to the point where I'm earning over $150, and then from there over $200 a month. So we'll see what happens come June and July. When next month results come in, then I can update this quarterly graph that shows that as well. You can see last quarter I made $204 in dividends, and we'll see what quarter two of 2019 I make. So anyway, don't want to spend too much time on this. I want to jump into the main topic, which is Costco.
What is it that Costco is doing so right that, say, Sam's Club is not?
Costco raises the standard of living for all of its consumers. So when beef was hitting record prices, Costco, the number one seller of prime beef worldwide, did not raise prices. Also, Costco pays its workers nearly $20 an hour. Walmart, Target, Kmart pay barely above minimum wage. Costco is full-time, so only 10% turnover with Costco, 50 to 100% turnover with competitors, and Costco does a lot for the community, which, with the exception of Target, the others do not.
I love that he calls it the formal Target instead of Target. Regardless, everything that he said here, I think is completely true. And this was said back in 2013. I don't think Costco's changed a whole lot since then. It is a very unique company, and I do think it honestly has the best business model of any company I can think of. This company has managed to do the incredible, like just do something remarkable. It's managed to return extremely good value to shareholders. It's managed to treat its employees way above the standard of its industry, way above what Walmart does or Target does, or the warehouse workers in Amazon or any of those employees are treated. They're treated much better at Costco. I wanna go and just give some background on what Costco actually is. I know a lot of people here are probably like familiar with them. You might even be members of it and go shopping there. But there's a lot of people that listen to this show from all over the world, and Costco isn't quite as big like internationally in Europe. So I'll go ahead and throw up some pictures to show you a little bit about the shopping experience. The first one here is an overlay. This is a top-down view of what their warehouse looks like. You enter in this bottom left part, the entrance there, and then it's kind of a horseshoe route that you go through. And then there's just aisle after aisle of merchandise, huge pallets of stuff stacked on top of each other. And it's pretty unique shopping experience. It's different than if you're just sitting at home browsing on Amazon. You're able to look at all this stuff up close and try it out. They have tons of displays, and it makes it almost just like an entertaining thing to do is just to go and walk through this store. So you can see here people going through. This is like the food section of it. There's another one here of just the rows of TVs. They have all these massive TVs right at the front of the store. And then as you go through, they have a clothing section. They have all the kitchen stuff, all the electronics. It's a giant warehouse. You can buy everything from A to Z in it. I wanted to go and just for a minute look at their corporate profile. Every company that's a major company you can invest in, they have, of course, like Costco.com, the consumer-facing website, but they also have these corporate profiles, and these are aimed at investors of the company that want to gain information before you invest in the company. This is showing off why you should invest in them and a little bit about their company. So this will give you a little bit of background. It says that Costco operates an international chain of membership warehouses. So they are membership-based. They charge $60 for the basic membership, $120 for the premium one where you get points based on how much you spend. But it says that they carry quality brand name merchandise at substantially lower prices than are typically found at conventional wholesale or retail sources. And that is true. One of the interesting things about Costco is that they have a maximum of a 15% margin on the items that they sell. So you pretty much know that you're not getting a bad deal on anything you buy there as far as profit margins are concerned. Where other retailers, they can mark up things 200 or 300% and they'll do that if they can get away from it. Costco will not allow that in their stores. One interesting thing to note here is they offer all these different categories, but the total amount of SKUs that they have in stores, meaning the total amount of actual individual items they have, different items, is around 4,000 in one of their warehouses. Whereas Walmart or Target have around 100,000 per store. So you might think, well, that's better. Walmart and Target have way more choice, right, to look at. But that doesn't always work in your advantage, because what Costco is able to do by having such a limited amount of products into their store is it creates a huge bidding war to get in their store. They're able to be extremely discriminatory towards the items that they put in there and make sure they get the ones with the lowest prices and that have the highest quality. And from my experience, most of the things you buy in that warehouse are extremely high quality. Part of the reason being is that they have to be high quality because you can literally return anything in the store. It says that Costco is known for carrying top quality national and regional brands with 100% satisfaction guaranteed at prices consistently below traditional warehouses or retail outlets. They're 100% satisfaction guaranteed. They are serious about that. I am not kidding. You can return anything to that store. Here's an example of that.
He says the woman there was getting a full refund from Costco. Why? Well, the tree just didn't stay alive long enough. Costco verified the purchase, and you know what? That woman got her money back.
This lady returned a live tree that she bought at Costco before Christmas and then returned it January after she used it for Christmas and it died. And what Costco did? They accepted the return. That's what I'm saying when they say they have 100% satisfaction guaranteed. They do not joke about that. There's been such egregious abuses of their return policy, like this lady and some others, that they have made some exceptions. If people are repeatedly returning items and it's clear that they're abusing the system, they will give them warnings or revoke their individual memberships. But I've returned all sorts of stuff there, never have had any problems. Part of that is a sales technique. Costco knows that if you know you can return anything that you buy in this store, including a live tree that you bought, and then later went around and returned it a month later, that you will spend more money there. A lot of my justification for spending money in Costco is the knowledge that if I don't like what I'm buying, I can return it. And in turn, what that does is make me spend way more there than other stores where I'm unsure, where I don't have the same level of confidence in buying from here. Costco's return policy is way better than anyone else's, including Amazon's. Amazon's, you have to have the pain of shipping it back, either going through printing shipping labels and dealing with all of that, dropping it off. Costco, you can just bring whatever it is, put it on the table, give them your membership card, and they just take it. So there's other examples of straight up abuses of this return policy. I looked on Reddit and there's a lot more stories of people returning things. There's one person that says that several years ago he bought a Samsung refrigerator and he owned it for like 3 years, and then the motherboard on the refrigerator got fried. He couldn't find parts to it. He brought it back to Costco, spoke with the manager, and they returned it, gave him a full refund for it, and that was after 3 years of owning a fridge. I mean, they are serious about their 100% satisfaction guaranteed. Now, you might think that's a negative thing for the company. Obviously, when there's people returning trees after they buy them for the season, like, that might be just considered a negative thing for the company. But what it does is making it so easy to return things to the company instills in you a confidence when you're walking through their store that you can just buy anything. And if you don't like it later, you can return it. That's the type of confidence it gives. Now, when you have that level of confidence when you're shopping, it makes you spend a lot more money. People spend a lot of money at Costco. This is a type of deal where you go in there for like 20 minutes to grab one thing and you end up walking out with $200 of merchandise. There's a clip from H3 where he actually made fun of this, and I was laughing because this is my experience so many times when I go into this store.
Spent like $1,000. I thought Costco was supposed to be cheap and have good deals. We spent $1,000. All I wanted was some eggs and milk, dude. Did you know they have a gas station, you know, at Costco?
That's pretty cool.
Now, obviously, Ethan here is a comedian, but this joke, I mean, it's honestly completely true. People go into this store and they have a way of just finding something that you feel like you need to buy every time you go there. And they do a lot of tricks to do that. If we go back to the map here, for instance, this part at the very end where all these refrigerators are, these little like teal parts in the back, that's where your basic staples are. The eggs and milk and just the meats, all the basics that you want to get. So you go all the way back there. They drag you through the whole store to go all the way back there. And in the meantime, you're seeing all this exciting stuff that looks fun to buy. You know, you can take it back later if you know you don't like it. And it creates this experience where you just end up spending a lot of money. Later on in that first video, they even talk about this phenomenon.
And remember, when you walk into Costco, it's this classic example of you walk in with maybe one or two things in mind, and then you walk out with like $200 worth of stuff,
That's
right?
That's true.
That is exactly what happens in this store. They're really good at converting just leisurely shoppers into high volume sales every time you go through the store. So I've talked a lot about the qualitative parts of Costco, some things I see in the company that I think are really good qualitatively. I want to move on to some quantitative stuff and look at the numbers and how they're pushing future growth. And that brings us to Kirkland Signature, which is the private label brand that Costco created. They have it all over their store, and the sales are increasing year over year on it really rapidly. This article is from 2017, but in 2018, Kirkland Signature revenued $39 billion. That's more than a lot of like just major brands in general. Kirkland Signature itself revenued that much. And what they use it for is it's an instrument to keep prices low in their stores. So it says, at Costco, negotiating for spot in the store is complex. Brands fight for space at the retailer's cavernous warehouse, which on average carries only 3,800 products. The typical supercenter sells over 100,000. Adding to the pressure, Costco often introduces a new Kirkland product when its buyers or executives believe the brand isn't selling at the lowest price possible. And so people ask me why I don't own like Procter & Gamble or Clorox or these other just big name brands. And this is part of the reason why, is because these private label brands can sell at such a lower margin that it puts downward pricing pressure on all these other brands. And Costco's doing that to them. Kirkland Signature has continued to sell more and more, and it's been able to lower the prices that of all the products that these companies sell. Amazon's doing the same thing online with them, creating their private label brands, competing with them fiercely. So I think that Costco has a big advantage with this. One of the parts of this article continues on with this. It says, when considering a new store brand offering, Costco looks for products that are our top sellers and can be sold for at least 20% less than branded versions without eroding profits or quality. Kirkland gives Costco leverage over brand manufacturers. Do you see what I mean there? So if you are the owner of Procter & Gamble, you have to know that other companies have leverage over the products they sell. They can create their own private label brands, which Kirkland Signature is creating a pretty good brand name, and they can charge lower prices, giving downward pressure on those products. That's what Costco's doing. Some people have said, well, Procter & Gamble might just manufacture those private label brands. They said that they don't do that. In one quote here, it says, "We have been pretty adamant across our lines that we don't manufacture private labels." That's what somebody from Kimberly Clark said. Now, I don't know whether they've changed their mind on this and they do this at Costco, but regardless, either way, it's putting downward pricing pressure on these other brands because Costco has their own brand competing with them. That's good for Costco, not good for these other brands, is really what it comes down to. Looking at the Seeking Alpha page for Costco, and we look at the graphs that we're all familiar with, we can look at some of the basic data about them. Right now, this company has a very low dividend yield, 1.2%. It's been growing its dividends consistently over 15 years. The average 5-year growth for it is almost 15%. The payout ratio is very low. If I go to the dividend history here, it's difficult to see because they paid these huge special dividends every once in a while here. People are speculating that they're due to pay one soon, just based off of their history. This dividend growth tab here gives a clearer picture. Costco has been increasing its dividend steadily over time for a very long time. Didn't get affected at all during the recession, held through it just fine. And then you can look at this. Over the last 10 years, again, average 15% increase in dividends, and 1 year, 14%, 3 year, 13%, 5 year, 14.5%. Really good dividend growth from this company. So even though they have a low starting yield, they have consistent growth. And one of the issues with this company is people are always trying to find a dip to buy in. They're always trying to find an entry point. It's very difficult to do because Costco always seems to be selling at a premium. The stock is just one that lots of investors like. Lots of investors never sell it, so you don't see any big dips. The last big dip I've seen on it was when Amazon bought Whole Foods. That created some worry with investors, and it dipped down like 15%. And ever since then, I haven't seen really another one. If I look at my portfolio, I go back to this consumer one. Costco, I'm up like 52% on. So this has been a really good one so far. But for all these other reasons, it's one that I think I'll continue to hold for literally decades in the future. It's a company that I will never sell as long as they continue running it the same way. The only time that I would change or feel differently about Costco is if they start to operate it differently. If they change their return policy, if they change the way they treat employees, if they change the quality of the products that they have. If those type of things change, then my outlook on Costco will change. But right now, I haven't seen that happen. I just seen them make improvements with their store and the way that they operate. So it's a company that I plan on holding long term. I think it's a good company to have as a dividend growth investor as well, even though it has a very low starting yield. So I'll wrap up my little mini analysis of Costco there. I hope this was at least interesting to give you maybe a different outlook into this company, bring up some things that you might have not seen about it. I plan on making this actually a new video series. I did the portfolio sector reviews where I went through and I looked at different graphs and just gave you a basic idea of why I invest in these different sectors and why I pick these different companies. But what I plan on doing is videos like this where I do a really deep dive into specific companies, just focusing on one company. And like I did with Costco, looking at a lot of things that you might have not considered when you look at investing in the company. But anyways, it's not supposed to be an exhaustive look, but hopefully this just gives you an idea, maybe some new things to consider when you're looking at and analyzing different companies. So I hope that was helpful. The last thing I want to do, like I said, I'm not going to do any questions. I wanted to just comment on one piece of news, and that was this. Buffett's charity auction breaks records with $4.75 million bid. If we jump over here, we see the winner of it, and it's a Chinese crypto pioneer. And this guy, his name is Justin Sun, and he's pretty much paying $4.56 million to sit down with him and a bunch of other buddies to try to do a sales pitch of cryptocurrency and his Bitcoin to Warren Buffett. So this article, I mean, from Bloomberg, it says, oh, to be a fly on the wall. Exactly what I would give to have this thing like broadcasted somehow where we could see what's going on. Because Warren Buffett and Charlie Munger have not said nice things about Bitcoin. People think the things that I say about Bitcoin are mean. I'm very You know, I just say that it's not something I'm invested in, but I don't hate it by any means or anything like that. Warren Buffett and Charlie Munger have said they've compared it to like rat poison, said that it's a really terrible thing to get into. They have an extremely negative outlook on it. And he's pretty much paying this much money to try to convince them otherwise. So I am really interested to know what Warren Buffett is going to say after this. Now, I know for a fact that if it was Charlie Munger, his mind would not be changed. Guy's way too old. He doesn't change his mind on things. He has his mind set on what Bitcoin is. Warren Buffett's a lot more diplomatic, a lot more nice in the way he says things. I could see him coming around and giving some concessions after it, but I don't know if I can see him completely changing his mind on it. I don't think that he's going to go out and tell anybody to invest in Bitcoin. Just my prediction, but we'll see what happens. I'm pretty excited about that. Other than that, I hope you guys have a good week. I'm going to be recording videos a lot more frequently, not on vacation anymore. So I have another one coming out. Again, if you follow me on Instagram, you'll be able to see a sneak preview of what the topic's going to be about. And yeah, I'll see you guys next time. You have a good one.